the Hearthstone Championship Tour for the Europe Winter Preliminaries. It's been quite a ride so far, a roller coaster to say the least. And here to break us down with what's been going on as well as some of his thoughts and maybe get to know a little bit more of him is D2, semifinals from 2014's BlizzCon. So D2, you've been enjoying the event a lot, but you know, what's been the most exciting thing for you having watched everything thus far?
Just being able to cast all these great players. I mean, even some of them that are going down, some of the plays they make are absolutely amazing. I mean, I'm getting corrected on like Twitter saying like, this is the reason why he played this play, because this next level kind of reasoning. And it's just really cool to see these players. Unfortunately, some of them are dropping, but I mean, just to be here to cast, it's an amazing experience.
Yeah, definitely. And you know, when we get to see all these pros dropping, it's kind of disheartening sometimes because they're favorite players, they love to follow, they want to see them continue to succeed. But some of these unknown players are the ones, you know, rocking the boat. Now, I kind of want to go back in the time machine here and say that 2014, you were one of those players. You were actually beating a lot of the fan favorites, you know, Tides of Time and all of them in North America, in order to get to BlizzCon itself and getting top four. You know, what was that process like specifically for you? And now that you've made a transition, now you're casting a lot more, what's that process been?
Well, I mean, in 2014, it felt really good to have all my hard work kind of validated, right? I was really working hard and kind of climbing ladder, winning tournaments, doing all that stuff, and preparing with my teammates at the time. And to be able to kind of, you know, put that on the field and or in the game, I suppose, and, you know, win all those matches, it really felt good. I mean, basically, I still just have pride when thinking about when I, you know, took out Strifeco in the round of eight, which a lot of people obviously thought was probably still is an upset at the time. So, yeah, it was really awesome, that experience, you know, having everything work out for me. And as far as transitioning to a caster, I mean, it's just something I really like to do. I really like talking about the game. And it's just great to be here. I mean, if you guys don't know, I've cast a lot of Chinese tournaments as well. And it's cool seeing all the different metas and just watching these incredible players play.
What's the one advice that you would give to some of these unknown players? They're making quite a splash. I mean, that was a really good opportunity to capitalize for them, because there's no bigger stage than the championship tour right now. What's your advice from D2, having been in that spot as an unknown guy, you know, upsetting the establishment? Go ahead.
Just believe in yourself. I mean, you're at that point, you've obviously proven that you're able to beat these top players. So just keep believing in yourself. You know you're a good player at this point, since you've been able to make all these great plays. So at this point, just keep riding it and don't be nervous, and just really just focus on, you know, getting as far as you can possibly go.
Thank God I asked you that question now, Rob. I'm pretty sure he would have started breaking out in a Journey song right here on the spot. Speaking of Rob, we're going to hand over to him as well as Aqua and Brian Kibler. They're waiting overside another tavern. Let's check out what they have to say about that.
Thank you very much, Dan. Rob, what do you have to say about that?
Well, yeah, maybe don't stop believing is the best advice to give someone. I don't think that's a bad thing, but whatever.
So yeah, joining me is...
So karaoke later?
Yeah. Karaoke.
NKBBQ? I'm down. Let's do it.
So yeah, this is the last game of today. And we've had a crazy tournament. We've had so many up-and-coming talent showing their stuff. I really love that sort of thing. What do you guys think of this? You know, these new players showing they can make it in big events.
Well, I think one thing it shows is that there are just a lot of very skilled Hearthstone players out there. We've been talking about, you know, these upsets and everything. But I mean, the Hearthstone tournament scene hasn't been around that long. It's not like these are, you know, players who have been established for years and years and years. There's bound to be a lot of players out there who just really haven't had their shot to really prove just how good they are, and this is that shot for them.
Right. I think it's also interesting, too. You know, we saw at BlizzCon that, you know, a lot of the more successful players were kind of bringing unexpected decks. They were bringing these strange lineups, and I think it just basically goes to show you never fully figure out the meta. You never fully figure out what's going to work, and what you look at and you're just like, these are the decks. This is what I need to bring. This will help me win. There's always room for more kind of analysis and figure out exactly what you need to be doing. And a lot of these tavern heroes and a lot of these unknown players are really sticking it to the pros.
And I've liked, like, we've seen a lot of Shaman, which is what I didn't expect. I thought Shaman was in kind of a weird spot. Face Shaman was really popular at one point. Then it kind of dipped back down and it picked up again. So it was kind of in flux. And then Hunter, we had Hunter earlier. It was just like standard mid-range Hunter from Gaara. And, you know, it's awesome to see some of these old classes come back and, you know, make an impact in such a massive event like this.
Yeah, I mean, we've seen a really diverse metagame and a lot of very sort of different decisions as far as what decks to bring from a lot of the players, both pros and the unknown players alike. We've seen a bunch of different takes on Warlock. We've seen several takes on Paladin even. We did just see the Anything Can Happen deck from Nyria in that last match.
Yeah, I'm very surprised to see Gaara brought the mid-range Hunter. I thought if anyone was going to bring Hunter, as someone who plays a fair bit of it, it was going to be that Face Hunter variant, because it does match up so well against Secret Paladin. But yeah, overall, very, very surprising afternoon, I think, to say the least.
So these are the players coming up, Lucari and Slash. And this line, no, these are diverse lineups. You've seen that Warlock pick has been very popular. The Rogue has been really popular with the pros, but as we know, the pros haven't been doing too well recently. What do you guys think of these lineups?
They're pretty diverse. I mean, like you said, there's really the Warlock between them that's shared, as well as the Mage. We haven't really seen a Mage deck that hasn't been Freeze Mage. We've pretty much only seen Freeze Mage out of players today, I believe.
Right. So obviously Tempo Mage was way bigger last year at BlizzCon. We actually saw, you know, Jab in the Americas Championship brought it. Hotform rode his specific version of Tempo Mage all the way up to, you know, second place there. Mm-hmm. And I'm kind of surprised we're not seeing it at all. At the same time, I know that when you're looking to win in a tournament, one of the things a lot of players tend to think to themselves is, all right, I'm not looking for variants. I'm not looking for a lot of the cool dizzying highs you might enjoy on ladder. And Tempo Mage can provide it, right? You rip that unstable portal, get something like Kel'Thuzad, get something crazy, Alec here, and it's super fun. It makes for great stories, but I think you're looking for consistency, and Freeze Mage really feels like it lines up so well against so many of the popular decks, with maybe the exception of Druid.
I also think that the difference between this year's format and last year's format changes a lot of the kind of decks you may want to bring. Freeze Mage, right, in particular, was a deck that was very vulnerable to specific decks. Now with a ban, you might have the opportunity to prevent your opponent from playing, say, Warrior against your Freeze Mage, or Druid against your Freeze Mage,
right,
which makes a lot more of its good matchups a lot stronger when you can take out the bad ones.
Yeah, you just don't want to face control. Like, if you face control or Freeze Mage, you're almost guaranteed a loss most of the time, and you don't want that situation to ever occur in a tournament. So when a ban comes into play, Freeze Mage generally becomes a lot stronger. And I like Freeze Mage because, you know, you have to think a lot about what you do on your side. Sometimes you ignore the board, you know, but there's a lot of maths you have to work out, a lot of, like, predicting in the future. So that's why I like that deck, like, seeing that in the format. But, you know, we have all the obvious ones, Secret Paladin, a lot of Zoo and stuff, but they're just solid decks overall, aren't mm-hmm. they? And they're the type of decks that can snowball out of control, and you want those decks in the lineup, I think.
There's a lot of interesting decision-making that goes into crafting your lineup for Conquest. And the ban adds an additional layer of strategy to that. You know, like we just said, it enables you to play decks like Freeze Mage that might otherwise be difficult to play in a no-bag Conquest field.
I really like, we've been seeing Rogue too. Rogue is kind of the old faithful deck, right? It has so many matchups where, you know, it's favored, I would say, and it doesn't really have that many matchups where it's actually bad. So we tend to see, obviously, when you run into something like Reno Lock, things can get a little bit hairy, but it does a great job against Zoo for the most part. It does a great job against the Hunter variants. Secret Paladin, it handles pretty decently. And Druid, even with the right sap, you know, if you get off a sap on that turn 5, get the Druid of the Claw off the board, you can very easily turn the game. So I really respect and I appreciate people who are bringing Rogue. And it's something that has played well all the way up to the Hearthstone World Championship level going back to last November.
Oh, well, we were just saying how we had only seen Freeze Mage so far, but Slash here is playing Tempo Mage.
This guy's my hero.
we got a Mana Worm coming out in turn one of this game, so much more my style of game than Freeze Mage, I have to say.
I mean, if he didn't ban the Warrior and played Freeze Mage, he would just be hitting himself right now because he'd be just walking into such a bad matchup. But Tempo Mage versus Control Warrior is not something I've had a lot of experience with because I don't play either deck. Mm-hmm. Do you guys have any thoughts on this matchup overall?
There are a number of interesting things going on in this match. Some of the things are related to the specific way that the Tempo Mage deck is built. Things like Water Elemental are one of the ways that the Tempo Mage deck can gain a large advantage over the Control Warrior deck because they can lock out the weapons with that freeze effect.
Right. I actually, after BlizzCon, I talked with Hotform a lot at BlizzCon last year, and he was really high on Tempo Mage, and it was the kind of deck I hadn't played a lot of. And I ended up sitting down and playing a lot more of it. And I played it pretty much all of December, all of January, played it to Legend in January. And it's just such a fun deck. But to Brian's point, there's so many different ways you can build it. And there's so many, making the swaps out to take like one mirror image out and then put in something like an Ethereal Conjurer totally changes the depth of your deck. I'm running Ronin currently in mine. And it's one of those decks where you can build it so many different ways. We saw the Lotheb in Slash's version, and mm-hmm. that's not a card I'm specifically running, but I could see a scenario where it's very, very useful against something like Control Warrior.
Yeah, and one of the cards that is particularly powerful against weapon-based classes is Mirror Image.
Yeah.
We see Mirror Entity, which is easy to confuse these two cards based on their names, but and here, you know, the Mirror Image protects your creatures from weapons. That's exactly what Slash is doing here. He is, preventing no going to no lengths of waiting here. He just wants to get in there right now. And the Frostbolt not only gets damage in, pumps his Mana Worm, but also prevents his opponent from potentially using a Fiery War Axe to actually kill the Mana Worm next turn.
It's an investment in his Mana Worm.
You know,
getting that Frostbolt down, that Mana Worm is so important in this matchup. And, you know, you get a bit of extra damage as well. And then when you drop the Flame Waker, you've got two problems then. Mm-hmm. You've got the Mana Worm and the Flame Waker. So I do like that Frostbolt.
Really digging Lucario's style, too, by the way. He has that Hogger in the background offering him probably all kinds of secret advice. And he's rocking the Love is in the Air card back. So this is very thematic for Valentine's Day, and I'm sure he'll get some kind of bonus for that. But yeah, that decision to put the Frostbolt into Lucario's face immediately, as you said, protects the Mana Worm. And it was also kind of a reflection of what else was in his hand. And against a Control Warrior, you have to go a little bit faster. But I'm not necessarily sure Slash even knows if this is Control Warrior where this popular's patron is.
It also sends a message, which is important. You know, you just tell your opponent, this is what this game is going to be like. Frostbolt you in the face, attack you, go.
Yeah, and this is definitely one of those things where you have to generally win it sooner than later. Duplicate, now that is interesting.
Yeah.
Because common theory on this is you run one Mirror Entity, you run one Counterspell, right? That's all you run. And Duplicate is kind of one of these fringe one-off cards that you include for the shock value, right? It's not something you expect to see, and if you played it down next turn, and the Piloted Shredder goes down, and you just get two Piloted Shredder. That is huge against a Warrior. That is absolutely massive, and that in and of itself could win the game.
Yeah, and here, though, Lucario has a pretty good turn with this Sludge Belcher. He's not going to have to do any proactively killing Slash's minions. And right now, that's pretty much stopping Slash board. You know, he has the possibility to, say, Flame Waker Arcane Missiles or use his hero power to ping it down. But it's going to be difficult for him to get through that and get any damage to the face this turn.
It's a bit of an awkward situation. You play this Flame Waker, you play the missiles, and that Armorsmith just sits there,
yeah,
gaining health for him. And he has to kind of figure out, do I want to give him health at this point? Do I want to deal with the Armorsmith first? And like you said, he does have ping as an option, so it looks like he's going to go around this line of play as well. Oh, well, that's not a good thing to get, especially for Duplicate if that was his plan.
Yeah, Novice Engineer is a pretty sad drop off the Shredder here, Slash. He still has, you know, some reasonable options here, and thankfully for him, I imagine there's a very good chance the Novice Engineer will just get killed by the Armorsmith, so it can potentially still enable that Duplicate to get some value later on.
See here in Slash's hand, he has the Duplicate, but these two Flame Wakers together with the lack of spells in his hand, he has the one Arcane Missiles, which he doesn't want to play with the Armorsmith down, but he really needs to draw into kind of more of these spells, and this gets even worse with something like Acolyte of Pain and Revenge. Now that is actually something I'm pretty okay with for Lucario going forward here, because he's going to get the armor, he's going to get the card draw, it allows him to clear the Mad Scientist, and, you know, having that big Game Hunter means that he can actually just get around the Mirror Entity fairly painlessly because of the two health on Big Game Hunter. And for the most part, unless it's Dr. Boom, you're not expecting to see too many things you actually have to Big Game Hunter from the Tempo Mage.
Yeah, this was a pretty mediocre start from Slash here with, you know, you don't want to be using your spells in turn two to just go face necessarily. And now we're getting to the stage of the game where the Control Warrior deck is extremely powerful. He has, you know, a lot of, as we can see, powerful high-cost cards in his hand. And Slash, he hasn't really been able to do that much damage so far. Lucario is already still at 27. This Flame Waker, though, going to reduce that by a little bit, most likely.
The problem is Lucario has two Shield Maidens in hand, so that's sustain. He has the Bash, which is removal and sustain again. And then if things get too hairy, he can just Alex himself.
Ooh, and he also just picked up a Death's Bite. That is an easy way to take out that Flame Waker right now, and also threatens to take out the Mana Worm with the Death Rattle effect next turn. So even if Slash does play another minion, it's very likely both of them will die next turn.
It's a shame Slash is on 7 mana here, because if he was on 8, I would absolutely love to see the Azure Drake into Duplicate,
yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because
yes,
you know exactly where that Death Bite would go, and getting two Azure Drakes would really be kind of the start of piecing together something. Lucario's opening hand was extremely top-heavy.
Yeah.
He had the Oxtrazi, he had the Dr. Boom, the two Shield Maidens. So really the opening for Slash was in the beginning of the game, and Slash's hand didn't really contour to that win condition. So I think he's got to kind of start figuring out how he can get the value from this Duplicate to really turn things around. And I'm not even sure you want double Flame Waker here. I think you just want double Drake.
Yeah, you have the opportunity to try to play, say, Flame Waker into Duplicate, but that Flame Waker doesn't really do that.
Ooh. Wow.
That's a big fellow, but we do know that Lucario does have that Big Game Hunter in his hand. Which,
even if he doesn't have it, though, it's one of those things where you have to be expecting there's an execute or something. There's just Control Warrior has so many means generally to remove a single big target.
Yeah.
To where if I'm Slash, I'm just thinking how many cards do I want to be milled before he just executes? I wouldn't play it.
Yeah, it's a bit scary, and especially if you decide to say go for Fel Reaver duplicate. Although he gets 2 8-8s out of it, but like you said, the mill will just grind him out.
It's even there's even Brawl, so it's not super attractive. And now this is interesting. I think he's going to try.
Oh, did he actually rope?
Oh,
Slash
it.
Actually spent so much time trying to figure out his play that he played a duplicate, and that's going to get him mana worms. And he did not. He didn't even ping. He had 2 mana left over.
Right. It definitely seems like he ran out of time while considering his options. And now the duplicate on the mana worm. That's not the end of the world, because there's certainly draws where you can punish a little bit, but Dr. Boom comes out, and that is a counter spell, I have to think.
Yeah.
Did he test for that beforehand? I can't remember.
I don't think he did.
Or was that just like, I just played Dr. Boom, I'm so far ahead.
As far as I know, he just played that Dr. Boom. I don't think there's another minion played since that other secret came into play.
Keep in mind, if that had in fact been Mirror Entity, and Dr. Boom was down, double Fireball would have killed him.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not necessarily thinking you penalize yourself too much for not playing around that. But when you're playing around Tempo Mage, one of the biggest things it's easy to forget is the reach Tempo Mage has. Mm-hmm. There's double Fireball and that's game, but Slash definitely on the back foot here. Even though Lucario's life total is actually reasonably low for a Control Warrior, he doesn't really have the resources to punish him.
And Lucario, we can see, has so many tools to keep himself alive.
Right.
The window that Slash has to actually push for damage here against Alexstrasza, double shield maiden, bash, it's very, very small.
He just doesn't have the tools he needs to punish kind of plays like Dr. Boom, which don't play defensively and protect his life total. Because now going to the next turn, now Lucario could like shield made an armor up and he's gained more health. Mm-hmm. And then from that point forward, he can just keep gaining health in some manner. And it's pretty tough for him.
Obvious weapon puns aside, Lucario does have all the weapons in the world he needs in his hand. He's got the life generation. He has the actual weapons. Something like Bash is actually really huge in this matchup because, as you said, it can remove a creature and give him health. He's got Acolytes if he wants to draw. He's firmly in the driver's seat. So from here on out, it's just kind of a matter of pacing himself to not lose much health. And we're going to see that Shield Maiden come out. That's basically 5 health right there. And he can just continue pressing what he wants. I assume he's going to, get rid of that Drake just to make sure no spell damage nonsense happens. But great spot for Lucario to be in. Oh, Conjurer. That could be interesting if he gets something like a Flame Waker.
What's in the box?
not Flame Waker.
Give me a win condition.
Flame. Why am I forgetting this? I play this deck so much.
Oh, Flame
Strike.
Lance?
Flame Strike.
Oh, well, he's pretty far away from being able to Flame Strike, but yeah.
He's there got it. Is.
Forgotten Torch wouldn't be bad here. You get rid of at least Dr. Boom.
I guess Forgotten Torch does give him extra damage later on. He can clear the Dr. Boom. I think probably the best option there.
Yeah, no, I think that's correct. He's able to use the torch to take down Dr. Boom, leaving himself with a 2/3 mana worm on top of his Conjurer. But even still, this is just a very, very rough position.
Right. Have to assume that the win condition at this point is getting down Antonitis double arcane missiles and just kind of hoping from there that the HP doesn't get too out of control. We don't know his deck list. He might be running Ronin. It's a fairly uncommon inclusion into this deck, but it is certainly possible. And this is why I like Ethereal Conjurer, just side tangent for a second. It is basically a fireball, right? Does 6 damage, gives you a card. Yeah, that 3 health means it dies easily, but especially in a matchup like this, it's probably going to take a weapon to get rid of it.
And you know what? Sometimes the card it gives you is Fireball.
Although thinking about it now, he actually could have bashed if he was more concerned about his health. But
I believe he's calculated this is in fact a counterspell. So
right.
I think that he wants to use his mana as efficiently as possible without running into that counterspell if he doesn't have to.
Sure, he has pretty much tested everything except counterspell, unless it's just some one-off ice block for some reason.
And this is the sort of position, if you are playing Tempo Mage, you just don't want to be in. You have to use your burn spells to clear off opposing minions. You have a much weaker hero power in a long game, so you need to be actually pressing the advantage that you do generate early on. But no advantage will be gained from this Fel Reaver. It is likely to die to that Big Game Hunter pretty much immediately.
And he can mill some cards if he really wants to, which is even worse because, like you're saying, he's playing defensively. He's not getting the tools he needs to win this game. Ooh. And now he burned Dr. Boom, one of his bigger cards, which he could have played if he hadn't got the Fel Reaver. And that might have put things in a little bit in his favor, but and there comes his Forgotten Torch as well, so he just lost another 6 damage.
I mean, I think people misevaluate the implications of getting your cards burned from Fellreaver quite often. You can just sort of assume those cards were in the bottom of the deck rather than the top of the deck if you don't actually go to the point where you hit fatigue. So yes, if the game was very long, that can end up meaning that Slash doesn't have enough resources to actually win. There's just not enough in his deck. But it's likely, I think, that Lucario will be able to close the game up before then. Arcane Missiles into... This is a scary situation. Have a card.
You want to play Fatigue? I'm going to play Fatigue.
I was going to say, the plan is milling now. We're on that mill plan to win.
Everyone's milling everyone. Hooray! He didn't even get one damage on the Big Game Hunter, so he can't even kill it.
He's got the Fireball.
He just played Arcane Missiles, drew his opponent 2 cards.
You can literally roast that dwarf if he wants to with a Fireball. 7 just damage as well.
Terminate with extreme prejudice, that dwarf.
I mean, I would kill Big Game Hunter at any opportunity. It's a card that that has plagued me many a time.
Well, yeah, he's kind of like the fun police. Are you trying to have a 7? Tag me, get off the board.
Oh, no, sorry.
No, none of that. And we see he decides to ping it. Have to imagine. Well, so if he swings a Deathblight, those minions would die anyway, but you probably think the Big Game Hunter will ultimately finish off the Azurdrake as opposed to the weapon charge.
He is hoping he's forgotten he has a weapon in equipped. He's just like, maybe he doesn't see the Deathblight. Maybe he's just ignored that. He's drawn so many cards. He must be distracted.
Ooh, there's
and
the bash.
Bash does get countered.
Gonna absorb the counterspell, and this is fine. He's gonna get armor from the shield block, draw a card.
Do you really want to draw cards now the fatigue plan is in play?
I mean, you're so far ahead. If you're Lucari, are you also very concerned about it? I don't know. You've seen Dr. Boomburned. Basically, the only thing you're possibly afraid of now is Archmage Antonitis. Mm-hmm. And with the Arcane Blast burned, you've seen 2 copies of Arcane Missiles. You've seen both Frostbolts. Yep. What are you actually planning to play around as an activator? And yeah, Slash kind of understands that there's really no way of crawling back into this one. He's lost too many resources. Can't activate Antonitis. So first game is going to go to Lucari.
Yeah, and we definitely saw the late game power as Slash's deck kind of failed to deliver in the early and mid game, and then the control warrior was just able to take it over with powerful cards.
You had a good starting point with the Mana Worm. The Frostbolt play was pretty smart, thinking of Fiery War Axe, but from there on it was a bit. He wasn't getting the momentum he needed from a deck like Tempo Mage, mm-hmm. right? You just need momentum constantly from the beginning. And if you give Control Warrior the breathing room it needs to just sit back and remove something, play something big that you have to deal with, you're just not going to win.
Yeah. I mean, while the Frostbolt did prevent a possible Fire War Axe from killing his Mana Worm, we actually know that there was no Fire War Axe at that point. So it ended up kind of just being, take some damage to the face. It would have been better served later on to possibly protect his minion, but obviously he's just trying to deal with the cards he has. He didn't have anything else to do that turn, and I think, given the hand that he had, that really was the right play.
Yeah, we also saw Lucari's Control Warrior very, very defensively heavy. Mm-hmm. We saw the 2 Shield Maidens, which is not something we see too much of anymore because it's a little bit slow. So getting that win for him is a very big deal, and Lucari's going to immediately go to his Rogue deck, which has Edwin Van Cleef, which is another interesting inclusion we don't always see.
Yeah, and Slash seems to be, well, probably playing a more aggressive Zoo style deck, and both Imp Gang Boss and Nerubian Egg are some of the better cards against Rogue. They're very, very resilient minions that can survive the Blade Flurry effects, and also just match up very well against the Rogue Hero Power, against Backstab, things like that.
Yeah, and Imp Gang Boss is just a nuisance as well. Having 4 health, a lot of the early drops have, say, free attack, so it doesn't trade well. And usually you could just dagger it, right? But it generates the 1/1, so you have to invest other resources to deal with them. So, like you said, a very good pickup there. He did throw away the egg, but now he's got double Haunted Creeper, so again, more sticky minions. They are vulnerable to Fan of Knives, but you need to keep a hold of that Fan of Knives, that Implosion, because that might be the card you're aiming.
Yeah, he's got 2 pair, and I think he's just going to go ahead and slam down the Peddler. Find out really quickly what options he's going to have from that Discover mechanic as 1 drops go. And these are not actually any of the premium things you would want as the Zoo player. Although, Young Priestess isn't bad, I don't think.
Yeah, Young Priestess is pretty good, both as just a 2-1 that your opponent has to deal with, as well as potentially buffing your other minions out of removal range.
Right.
He does just choose to go with the Jouster, which was actually the other card there that I think is a reasonable choice.
It plays around Fan of Knives really well, which is problematic.
It's good against the Hero Power. It's good against Fan of Knives. And if you happen to just kind of get lucky and hit the Joust, which isn't really that unlikely against Rogue. It's not like they have a bunch of big minions in their deck. You just get a 2-3 for 1 with no drawback.
Yeah, the highest cost is 5, right? Low fare.
7. Sprint.
Oh, oh,
it's only minions.
Oh, it's only minions.
Maybe Dr. Boom.
There could be Dr. Boom in the deck.
Tice did have it in his.
Generally speaking, you're going to actually have a pretty close range of cost in your deck compared to the rogue. They probably have a higher average cost because they have fewer minions and thus fewer low-cost minions.
Right.
But it's not that far apart.
It would have been very awkward if Sprint came out on the Jazz. Like, you're not a minion.
Wait a minute.
There is a guy on the card, though,
it's
like an
true.
Owl.
So.
I think that's why I got confused. I was like, running guy.
Joust, he's pretty good at jousting. He just runs with his own lance.
I mean, he technically makes more sense than most of the cards.
So Lucari, thinking for quite a while there about whether he wants to backstab that Dark Peddler, it looks like he's deciding to save it to try and play, I imagine, a 4-4 Van Cleef on the next turn. Which makes a lot of sense because an early large Van Cleef puts a lot of pressure on the Warlock Zoo deck in terms of forcing it to trade away its early board position.
Right, and now these choices, see the Young Priestess again. We see Zombie-chan, we see Blood Imp. This again, the Young Priestess, yes, it plays into Phantom Knives and Hero Power, but I think it has the most upside. Blood Imp, probably just going to get Phantom Knives, doesn't do any damage, and I think as a Zoo player, you really prioritize that 2 damage on the Young Priestess.
Mm-hmm.
And Young Priestess once had a place in Zoo back in the day.
That's true.
So she's just popping up twice now. Come on, pick me again.
Wait, remember me? Gul'dan, we used to hang out. We were cool back then.
And there comes that Van Cleef. Not so mighty 4-4. Van Cleef.
On
still...
this board, it's the mightiest thing around.
Right.
And, you know, a Slash doesn't have right now an abusive Sergeant or anything that can actually clear it off. So that's actually going to be, you know, the dominant minion on the board for the foreseeable future.
And the 4-attack clears up the Imgam boss, which is one of the problem cards sometimes when you got the free drops like the Farseers and the SI7s. He's actually not going to go for the Imgam boss, which I like because it does get cleared up very nicely, and he's going to force him to use the Van Cleef on other minions first.
It's kind of an interesting situation for Zoo to be in, but he just had so many options there. And it was just kind of, which 1 and 2 drop combination do I want to use? And he's like holding them up. He's like trying them out, see what they look like. He's like, egg and imp? He's like, nah, spider and imp.
And it looks like we're going to see Van Cleef crack the spider and the Phantom Knives come out, which will allow Lucari to clear off either his choice of Peddler or Flame Imp. I'm going to guess he's going to go with Flame Imp, since that's the only minion that actually threatens Van Cleef in this board.
Love seeing the prep right here. Prep is a great pickup, works super well with Azure Drake, allows for an incredibly powerful turn 5 where you play the Drake, play down a preparation, and then you go for the Eviscerate. And you generally just get bored right there. And then if you're the Zoo player, it's kind of on the back of a 4 damage implosion for you to get the board back if your board is in fact cleared.
Here, Slash has a couple of options to play a board that's pretty safe against clearing. He has the Nerubian Egg and the Haunted Creepers Watch. He does go with the Jouster, who?
Oh.
Oh,
no. That's some good information to have, though.
Dr. Boom unsurprisingly wins the joust against Voidwalker.
Voidwalker probably tried, though. Tried really hard. It's not his matchup to win. And see there, he's just going to go ahead and put that Peddler face, do some damage. And the buff on the Gadgets and Jouster, that's fine. It's not bad. But it really isn't game-changing, especially since that's a 1-3 as opposed to a 2-4 it could have been.
Yeah, Drake comes down, so prep.
3-4.
Prep, it probably doesn't seem that great at the moment. The board is not threatening. This is a problem Slash has had, kind of mirrored from last game. He just hasn't developed enough of a threat with these kind of faster decks. And Lucari is just sitting back and doing what he wants.
Well, this game, Slash's problem has actually been that Lucari had that Van Cleef along with Backstab that allowed him to actually get ahead on the board very quickly. And now Slash is kind of the one who's in the back foot. And you know, last game, he just didn't quite have the ability to generate those threats. This game, he has the threats. His threats are actually quite good. The problem is that Lucari has all the right answers.
So, beginning of this game, we see the 2 Haunted Creepers, we see the 2 Dark Peddlers. Slash, right out of the gate, decides, I'm going to play down the 2 Peddlers first because I want to see what options I get. But the downside of that is, obviously, 2 Dark Peddlers is a lot easier to clear than 2 Haunted Creepers.
Absolutely.
So now we're kind of seeing the ramifications of this, wherein the Haunted Creepers were not out, and the Peddlers are pretty easily dealt with and kind of ignored now for the most part.
That Power of Warning pickup, though, does allow Slash to clear off Lucari's board, and now he has a couple of spiders along with that egg. And Lucari now has just reactive cards. So this game's turned around a little bit this turn. Lucari went from having a big board presence to just playing this heal bot to try and keep himself above water.
I think of all the classes you want to have sap against, Zoo is probably one of the least.
Oh, yes.
Oh, yes.
Maybe you try to get around something that's Defender of Argus, maybe an egg that's Defender of Argus, for example. But otherwise, you don't really feel like you get a whole lot of value. And I think that's actually a pretty good draw right there.
Lotheb's a very strong card in this matchup, and particularly for Slash, seeing that Lakari just played Healbot that turn, that likely indicates he doesn't have much in the way of other strong minions. His hand is probably full of reactive cards. That said, I think this play from Slash here, he's clearing off the Healbot and just developing more threats. I think this makes a lot of sense.
I think I would have liked Lotheb, because if he does have a handful of spells, and if he was to draw Sprint next turn, that would have been a great way to get minions back into his hand. But again, he's developing another threatening board now, but it does give Lakari an option to use these cards now, which are in his hand. Dr. Boom, that's a pretty great pickup too.
Dr. Boom's a pretty nice card this turn. He also has the prep, so he could, if he wanted to, Boom Prep Sap. Right. Which might give him some breathing room on this board and prevent his Boom from even really being at real threat of being cleared.
Yeah, I really like Dr. Boom prep and then eviscerate the Nerubian.
I like keeping hold of eviscerate for now.
I'm not sure whether I like eviscerate or sap here better. Both of them, I think, are pretty strong. Eviscerate has, I think, more utility just as a finisher later, potentially. So yeah, I think we're going to see the sap.
I mean, those saps have been sitting in that hand for a while now. Just get rid of one. You've got another. So, and like you said, it's a poor card in the matchup compared to a lot of other tools Rogue has. So that was a perfect opportunity to use it.
Yeah, and you can't actually see Slash's hand, but that really kind of clogs up Slash's hand pretty nicely.
Yeah, it's fantastic here. The Nerubian, if Slash decided to, play Doomguard, you know, he's just going to lose it. It's effectively just killed it with the sap. If he plays Lotheb, he can't replay the Nerubian this turn because it does cost three. So that actually is going to work out very, very well for Lakari.
Very curious to see if he's going to choose to just pretty much trade everything into Dr. Boom to get rid of it, or if he's going to make the decision that it's time to maybe get a little bit more offensive. But I think either way, it might have to start with a tap here if he is going to play down that Lotheb.
Well, if he plays Lotheb, he might also want to play Abusive Sergeant.
Right.
To actually allow him to only trade two of his minions into the Dr. Boom. But he does choose to tap first.
You can deal with these Boom Bolts nicely, though, especially if they start hitting the imp below damage. You get some value out of it. But like you said, he tapped, so the Abusive isn't even an option to go for the Dr. Boom now. So I imagine Lofeb's going to come down, or is he just going to drop one for in a 4-4? I guess he's waiting for a good moment for Lofeb, maybe where he feels like he might die.
The Rogue deck has so many powerful possible spell turns that it can generate, and well, this is going to be one of them.
This is definitely one of them.
We're going to see the Tinker into Flurry, which will clear Slash's board with the exception of one imp off the imp gang, and also happen to do 4 damage to his face, and Dr. Boom, 4 to the face. And this we see, I think, why he chose to keep the Eviscerate and use the sap. Because now, that Eviscerate is starting to just end the game next turn.
Yeah, and unfortunately for Slash here, looking at his hand, there isn't anything that just immediately screams, this is the way I get out of this situation. He's going to start piecing some stuff together. He could throw the Doomguard and then something like the Abusive Sergeant into getting rid of the Dr. Boom, but it feels really awful. You don't want to have to do that. He's pretty much just throwing stuff on the board at this point, trying to mount some kind of counterattack if he's not dead next turn.
At least Dr. Boom is silenced.
He's a quiet Dr. Boom. He's not making any noise.
No more of that. No more of that telltale laugh.
And there's two Eviscerates, but they cannot get the job done because Slash did play that Lotheb to lock out Lakari from playing multiple spells, essentially.
So if you're Lakari at this point, do you think there's any universe where you're dead next turn?
Not one in which you attack in Blade Flurry because you just get so much damage off the board.
Right. One card in hand. There's just no way it happens.
Yeah, Slash, he's at 2 life. He can't even life tap. So, yeah, his best option here is to try and trade, push with Doomguard, but Lakari has Eviscerates to spare to end this game next turn.
Too many Eviscerates. And this is kind of the board Slash would have wanted about 3 turns, two or 3 turns ago. And Eviscerate, no combo needed.
There it is.
2-0 to Lakari. Slash is not finding what he needs to get any wins on the board right now.
Yeah, I mean, that game, both players had pretty good starts. Lakari's just happened to line up very, very well. Not only against Slash's draw, but specifically against the line that he chose to take early on. As you mentioned, if those Haunted Creepers had come down rather than Dark Peddlers, the removal plan that that Lakari had access to wouldn't have worked quite as well.
We also saw there where Slash was trying to piece together the board before the Blade Flurry. He's just like, I'm going to throw down as much as humanly possible, build the biggest board. He hadn't seen a Blade Flurry yet. He hadn't seen Tinkers. And sure enough, Lakari's like, well, if you want me to, I guess I'll just blow up your entire board. And unfortunately, Slash was left in a really bad spot. But I understand why you do that.
he didn't really have much of the way of options there. If you give the rogue deck time to assemble all of the pieces it needs, you're going to get a lot worse than a Blade Flurry for four. it's going to go badly for you.
Do you feel the Van Cleef was a big part of that win?
It was huge. The Van Cleef coming down as a 4-4 on turn three gave Lakari just early board presence that he was able to leverage throughout the early and mid game and ultimately into a victory.
He got like a free for one, didn't he, with that Van Cleef? It
cleared loads of stuff. Yeah, it really did. It was a huge threat, primarily to Slash's ability to actually pressure Lakari, because that's what matters there. Right. The Rogue deck is the one that kind of has inevitability, because it has enough card draw and enough tools to win a long game that the onus is on the Warlock to actually end the game.
Right, having the Van Cleef just able to pop up in those Haunted Creepers, get the Spiders, lead to the Fan of Knives, because a lot of times what you find as a Rogue is you have these board clear options, but because of the stickiness of minions, you don't necessarily have convenient clears, but that Van Cleef was just opening up everything for him.
Well, no Van Cleefs in this game. We have Slash once again playing his Tempo Mage deck against Lakari, who is on Warlock. He will be playing clearly an aggressive style of Warlock deck.
Yeah, so Lakari gets his shot at playing Zoo now, and this matchup can go either way, I find. It very much depends on the start of the Tempo Mage. Can he get those spells to deal with, like, the Knife Jugglers? Frostbolt's super important. Sorcerer's Apprentice, I feel, plays quite a nice role as well, reducing the cost. Arcane Missiles is another one as well.
Yeah, a lot of this can come down to the early and mid-turns of the game. Flamewaker is one of the very powerful cards in this matchup, because there are often so many small minions on the side of the Warlock that it can help really, really clean things up in the mid game.
Imp Gang Boss is one of the minions I want to point out. It's very problematic for the Tempo Mage to deal with, because of stuff like Flamewaker, Arcane Missiles. These individual sources of one damage become really problematic, because Imp Gang Boss just sits there spewing out imps, and it's difficult to ever truly recover the board. Mm-hmm.
I really love Gormok showing up in Zoo a lot now.
Gormok, I think, is an excellent card. That was a card that I think was very much underappreciated when it first came out, but has since definitely proven that is very powerful.
I love this. The Flame Cannon is such a deceptively powerful card, especially in this matchup because of that Imp Gang Boss. And we're going to see the ping to get rid of the Imp Leftover.
Well, and this is really big with the Sorcerer's Apprentice as well. Reducing the cost allows him to get rid of that. So even with that Abusive Sergeant, Lakari cannot actually get back in the board.
This is a little bit less smooth of a turn, because I think you really want to play down that Shredder, get the sticky minion on the board, but Bran can be such a nuisance for Zoo.
Yeah, Bran can be a really big problem.
I'm surprised to go for the missiles. I guess he wanted to see if he could get the Arcane Blast. Yeah. Okay. I didn't quite register the Arcane Blast, because I always think when you got missiles, that implosion is what you want to hit with it. But that was just clean for him.
Yeah, that ended up working perfectly for Slash. He was able to get the Bran off and still have the mana left over, thanks to the Sorcerer's Apprentice, to play that that Shredder. So now he's very much ahead in the board.
Right. That said, Slash is a little bit low on cards. He has the spells, which I'm pretty sure he's relying on at this point to keep the board clear, make it friendly for him. Frostbolt lines up perfectly into dealing with that Knife Juggler. But at the same time, unless he kind of draws something to...
That's a card.
Unless he draws something to work with those cards.
Unless he draws something with disgusting synergy, like Flamewaker.
And we were just talking earlier that Flamewaker is one of the cards that can really put the nail in the coffin in the mid-game here. And that looks like what it very well may just do.
Oh, wow. Is he going for the risk of popping the egg with the Juggler down?
That would be extremely risky if he went for this. I'm not sure I could recommend this one.
And there it goes.
Yeah.
Slash recognizing that was not what he wanted to be doing there. And that actually may cost him fairly big here, because he's not going to be able to cast both these spells he wants.
Ooh, and that spider surviving is absolutely problematic for him.
Yeah, definitely. That not only threatens to kill the Shredder, but also can potentially, with some help, could take down the Flamewaker.
It's very dangerous leaving the minion up against Zoo, just because of Overwhelming and all the other buff cards they had. That was a very risky play for the Tempo Mage.
Well, we saw the whoops come out, and I wouldn't be surprised. Yeah. Slash, this might be his first time at this level of tournament play, and it definitely seems like the nerves are getting to him a little bit, so it's perfectly understandable. And yeah, at this point now, he's lost board, he's going to have to fight to get it back, and I'm not sure.
And now without the Flamewaker, this Arcane Missiles is much less exciting. And Slash is pretty much out of cards. You know, he has a Shredder and a Prayer right now. And Lakari has Life Debt.
I mean, this is the moment of the game where the Tempo Mage should have just got bored at this point, and now they're just hitting face, and they're just racing the zoo, because you can't just trade the zoo forever, because he'll just keep dropping minions. But now, like you said, he's out of cards, he has a Shredder. It's his final hope, unless he draws something great next turn, like a Dr. Boom, to kind of bring him back into the game.
Yeah, he needs some help. Something like a Unstable Portal could be big. Something like Arcane Intellect, or an actual big card like Dr. Boom or Antonitis is really what he's looking for. That said, the Tempo Mage deck has a ton of cards at this point. What's in the box?
Death Lord's not bad against you.
Okay, that's all right. Yeah, that can potentially protect that Shredder. Death does
not scare me. Now he just needs to show a little bit of patience with the Shredder. Ping can clear the Death Lord now, and maybe the Shredder can do some more work.
We do know that obviously Lucari has a lot of stuff in his hand. He's actually getting really close to being able to play that Gormok and get the value. Which,
and this egg's actually a really nice draw because it allows him to play one of his four drops on curve here. So he could either play the egg and a Dark Iron Dwarf attack into the Death Lord, or taunt up both those eggs and help protect his life total, which I think is what he's most concerned about right now.
I think taunting up both of these eggs pretty much takes a ground assault out of the equation for Slash, and now it's pretty much going to have to be from the air. He's going to need those spells, and we haven't seen either Fireball, so it's certainly within the realm of possibility, but he's going to need some big stuff to get control of this board again, which I don't think he really even can as a Tempo Mage. So hoping to see those spells, hoping to see Dr. Boom would be welcome as well.
I mean, popping open 2 4/4s as well as all the other stuff he's going to be playing next turn is going to be devastating for Slash. I think this Argus might seal the game.
Well, a Shredder is one of the relatively high-impact cards that Slash can draw. We'll see what comes off of this one, which I imagine he might be attacking with at this point. Maybe not.
I mean, you still have that big wall up there, so maybe you just pass.
Yeah, you do have the 2/7. You don't want to actually give your opponent more power on board. Yeah, that's definitely right to not play it. But this will allow the Dark Iron plus Gormok to take down the Death Lord, and we will see what Lucari gets in his box.
Wow, that's so clean as well, with the Gormok on top of that. Mm-hmm. So he's going to get... Well, he's got 2 4/4s on the board from what he played. When those eggs pop, 2 more 4/4s are going to show up. So
yeah, this game was looking great for Slash early on, but it really turned the corner.
Yeah, the Great Wall of Death Lord is about to come down. We'll see what hidden treasures lie beneath. There probably just be a Flame Imp or something, which is still great because you don't have to pay the 3 health.
It's true. regardless of what he gets, I mean, he has a really kind of overwhelming board presence at this point.
Yes, you guys are calling
this. You're not the only one who can predict cards, Ren. I may not be able to find the right play, but I can predict cards.
Fortune Tellers of Hearthstone.
The Mana Addict, a little bit intriguing. If something like a Fireball comes...
If Slash draws like Arcane Intellect into something,
Azure Drake.
I think you get big. Okay, he's got spell power. That takes out a 4/4.
One of many 4/4s.
True. Unfortunately.
So you just ping the egg and just go face and hope for the Fireball draw?
I think you perhaps are past the point that you can really do much fighting for the board. How much damage does he have? He has 7. Assuming he casts the Arcane Blast, yeah, he'll attack for 7. He will put Lucari down. It's actually only 8. He won't be able to draw a lethal Fireball if Lucari does kill the Azure Drake. Although Lucari would have to kill his entire board to prevent Fireball from being lethal.
Right, so
I like face too,
but I'm curious to see how Lucari responds this turn if it is in fact face, because like you said, he will be at 8. He'll be drawing 1 card unless he gets something like Arcane Intellect, in which case you still can't double Fireball. You could Fireball into Frostbolt.
This may give him enough time. Well, I was about to say it may give him enough time to draw 2 cards, maybe draw a Fireball and a Frostbolt, but Doomguard and the Knife Joker is going to make things a lot more scarier.
Smork, good play, Smork.
I do believe that is the order of the day. Oh, look at the tie. All right, that's a reasonable result. Not super great, and really not very impactful in this situation.
Lucari also not only wants to play such that he fades the Fireball next turn, but also wants to prevent his opponent from having too many more draws to actually just draw Fireball into Fireball.
I have to assume that Mana Addict is going to get traded out of here.
It does take
crazy.
The juggle, so
totally
still Slash at 19. There's not 19 in play.
This could be
a Fireball. What's in the box? Polymorph Boar. That's 4 damage right now.
Crown of Cold will stop things for a while, but
I actually think you want to take Polymer 4, hit your opponent in the face for 4. I don't know how you win this game other than drawing a burn spell next turn.
That's true, yeah. So
if you hit your opponent for 4 with the Polymer 4, ping them. He's down to 3. You leave yourself with Frostbolt isn't out as well.
But that assumes you draw a minion for the polymorph to be worked on.
No, you can cut in your own guy right now.
Hopefully,
wow,
slash.
No, why am I so bad at this? Yes, you're right. You're completely right. You just put it now and then draw the fireball.
He drew Huffer. It was a very expensive Huffer. Oh, he's not going to Huffer. All right, he's trying to play a little more defensively.
You got to take a risk at this point, right?
The thing is, I'm not sure what he is like able to draw at this point to win.
Yeah, because he didn't have enough mana for the ping.
Mm-hmm. He would have if he Huffered.
Yeah, let's see.
Well, it wasn't a Frostbolt.
Ah, well.
Yeah, that is actually... It's actually just going to do it, I believe.
Yeah, it looks like this is... There's no way out for this one for Slash. He can ping down the Juggler, but that still leaves exactly 15 damage on the board on the other side. Here he's just hoping that Lucario just doesn't notice. Maybe he'll just unmask.
Lucario's
I actually missed the point that was actually had 1 health left. He's actually 1 off lethal right now. Not anymore, though.
Oh, no.
Dagger's going to go flying.
Oh, and a 4 as well. There's the rub-in right there, the 4 off the implosion.
That has to be the most stylish win I think we've seen. The implosion for 4. Didn't need it, just needed 3.
But Lucario with a commanding performance, winning the match 3-0 against Slash.
That was a clean victory for Lucario, and I do believe this is winners, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so Lucario played really well, but I also think, I want to just point out again, I think Slash had a little bit of the case of nerves. I mean, you've seen this before where players, they get to kind of a high point of tournament, and you know they know they're on camera, and it's one of those things where maybe that's a new experience for them. Obviously, that's one of those things where it can totally mess with you when you are at this level. Lucario, no nerves though. Very all business, made the correct plays, was very impressed with how he did.
Yeah, absolutely.
And the beauty of these preliminaries and these championships, this is not his only opportunity. This is not Slash's only time he can compete in this. He has all the other seasons as well. So this is a building point for his career.
Not to mention, he's still just moved to the lower bracket.
That's true,
he still has an opportunity to make it through to the championships next month.
Yeah, so, you know, Slash, although he lost this game, he's not out, and he still has plenty of opportunities in the future to kind of build on that, well, any success he finds in this tournament. So, you know, it's an exciting time for him getting this far with so many killers in this tournament as well, and them going down to lower. So, yeah, I'm quite excited to see what Lucario can bring as well, because we just saw a very convincing win from him, but Slash is not out.
Right, and as someone who's played a lot of Tempo Mage lately, I am a big fan of Tempo Mage, but at the same time, this kind of continues that curse of Tempo Mage. It's something that pro players are very much divided on, whether or not this is kind of a top-tier deck you bring to tournament. And it's obviously served Slash very well to get to this point, but there are just points where you do not get the things in the sequence you need them, and you don't necessarily get like the crazy unstable portal play, and then it kind of falls a little bit flat. And we saw that against the Control Warrior, which was all just, you know, this is it, I'm just going to survive. And Tempo Mage exists in that weird point where it's an aggro mage, but not quite.
The problem is that unlike Zoo, like Zoo is a deck that you have a bunch of minions, and you play a bunch of minions, and well, sometimes you draw better minions at certain points than others, but they're pretty interchangeable. Whereas Tempo Mage, you have Mana Worm for turn one. You know, you have a couple of other minions for turn two, and the rest of your deck, you know, that you can draw that's cheap spells is cheap spells that don't actually put on the pressure early on. And if you don't draw the right mix, sometimes things just don't come together.
Sometimes you just need those line of cards to make things work.
Yeah.
It's quite like an engine that has certain pieces that need to go in, and then it's the cogs start turning. And if it doesn't, it can just fall flat. And that's the problem with Tempo Mage, I guess, as a deck. As a whole, like, you do have these moments where you don't get Mana Worm, because Mana Worm's so important sometimes. Like, that, because you can only have 2 of them, like, and how important they are. Maybe one day they'll get another one drop, which can kind of help Mana Worm out.
Right, and obviously, to your point, you know, Zoo's full of spells, Tempo Mage is full of, or Zoo Mage, Zoo Mage.
Zoo
is full of minions. Tempo Mage is full of spells. And when you're playing those spells, you're not developing minions, so you're not getting that long-term presence on the board. You're just basically making reactions to other things. Mm-hmm.
We've had a fantastic day today, guys. Brian, any kind of highlights for the day? What do you think of the overall performance of the tournament players?
I think that really what this event has showed so far is really how Playing in events like your local Tavern Hero events and playing in local cups and things like that can get you to the big stage where you have the opportunity to play against all these big names. We've seen, you know, many of the Tavern Heroes have been performing extremely well in this event. And, you know, it's not just the world of the pro ringers, really. It's anyone can come and have a chance to win.
Right, and I really like the approach for a lot of these guys where they're coming in, they're just kind of like, all right, I'm going to bring either, you know, these unique lineups, or I'm going to bring just aggro. I'm just going to go for it. I'm going to make you have the answers. And that's why aggro is so prevalent on the ladder, right? Because it's one of those things where you force your opponent to have the answers. If they don't have the answers, you just kind of win out. And we saw some of the pro players bringing some more meticulous deck stuff like Freeze Mage. But again, Freeze Mage requires kind of a lot more to make it work, whereas something like Seeker Paladin, you play it down, it's just inherently strong, and you just kind of hope to go from there.
And if you're in a format where you know there are players who don't have experience or just like getting into their kind of stride as a professional half-stone player or just a ladder player, aggro can make them tilt. Aggro can put the pressure. And that's what aggro does. Like, it does it in the game, and it can maybe do it psychologically as well, you know, getting whooped by aggro twice in a row, you're like, oh, no, I don't want to fight another aggro deck. So, you know, that's another way you can play the game. Or you can just play more solid mid-range, you know, where you know they're all solid decks and they have kind of the same fundamentals with just little bits in here. But that's the nice thing about having so many variety of different players. They all bring different things. We've seen Control Warrior, didn't expect that. Murloc Paladin as well, although it's on the rise. You know, we got to see that too. And Nyria brought some fantastic decks.
Yeah, like Nyria was playing the Fatigue Warrior even, the Deathwing, Deathlord. Death Warrior, I guess. I don't know. But
that's actually, that's the thing, though. You bring something like that, you're like, nobody's expecting this. Mm-hmm. So, yeah. And that, to the, like, anything can happen. Fatigue Warrior, these are things you do not expect to see in tournament. And, you know, Nyria, not necessarily super served well in that last series, but, you know, it's something that there is merit to bringing that sort of lineup. Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
All right, guys, that's it from us at the desk. Thank you very much for tuning in. It's been a great day. We're going to go over to Danny. He's going to have a little chat with you guys before we close things off. So until tomorrow, be sure to tune in, and we'll be back.
Thank you so much, Nick and crew. That's right, we are done with our first day here of the HCT kickoff. That's right, it's just the beginning of the championship tour, and we have so many stories already forming. The big one today, as we've mentioned many times over, is the fall of the establishment. So many of the pro players that we're used to seeing have been eliminated or knocked down to the bracket. I want to give a quick final update of what we see off stream for you guys before we send you off and do some of our homework. Let's go ahead and talk about Crane, who is a player that we've been paying attention to. He went to the winner's round 5, but he has dropped to Prokhorovich, who has been another surprise player going through. Another update from winner's round 5 is Diggin has managed to defeat Tom. And these names might sound really vague to you now, but pay attention to how things are going. In the meantime, let's go ahead and meet another winner from round 5 and get to see how he's feeling about the match, because I think he has a lot to say about everything going so far. So congratulations, Lakari. How do you feel about being able to go this far into the HCT Winter Prelims for Europe? Yeah, can you hear me right now? Okay, I can't hear him right now, my audio. All right, so Lakari, I'm not a lip reader, I apologize. I skipped that class in high school. So we're gonna come back to you when we fix our audio real quick. In the meantime, I just wanna give also some updates about some other people. Kalento has been eliminated in round 4. He played his heart out, as well as Oskaka, the world champion we saw earlier today. He's eliminated in round 5. But some of your favorite players have actually gone through to day 2, I believe. We have Super JJ, Sho, and 6-0 holding it down in the lower bracket, as well as RDU is finishing up his match. We'll check in with him at the very end. Of course, if you guys are curious, you can go ahead and follow all of the brackets and everything. Make sure to tweet on social media as well, hashtag HCT, as well as tweet at us, Play Hearthstone. If you're on Facebook, you can also go to facebook.com/Hearthstone and check out all of the matches. Tomorrow, we're going to be starting at 2 p.m. Central European time. For us in North America, that's also very early. That is at 5 a.m. PST. And with that, I believe the audio has been fixed. Let's go ahead and hop over to Lakuri again and see how he's checked in. Can you hear me now?
Actually, again, I want to thank everybody who helped me to prepare for this tournament. I have a lot of different strategies. And my main idea and my main goal was to make a lineup which will play well against every meta deck well, like Druid and Zulok and also Secret Paladin. Actually, I knew that a lot of players will bring here Patron warriors like Thais and Crane. I really expected. The main idea was to ban warrior every game. I hate playing veterans, and I hate playing against control warriors. They are really boring, and they are really strong to get a really opportunity with, versus them. So my goal was ban warrior. Then I pick four decks that I play pretty well. I my main deck always was Zoom Warlock. I played it since beta, I guess, and I really know this deck really well. I know how to win with it with anyone. So it was my first. Then I take Oil Rogue, and my also one of the top decks like Freeze Mage. The last one was Control Warrior to play well against Freeze Mages, and also I tuned it to play well against Druids. Today I played four games against Druids at one. So I really appreciate everybody who watched me. See you tomorrow, guys. Good luck and have fun with in this game.
I don't think anything needs to be asked anymore. Congratulations, Lucario. You're going to the next round. And with that, we are done here with our first day of the Hearthstone Championship Tour for the Europe Prelims. Congratulations to all of our winners, but their job is not done yet. We're taking the top eight tomorrow right here at twitch.tv/playHearthstone. A big shout-out to our casters, the Villas production crew, who has been up since 2 a.m. in the morning here from California to broadcast it, as well as all of our regionalized languages across the Twitch channels. Shout-out to them as well. We'll see you guys back here once again, 2 p.m. Central European time, right here on the channel for Frodan and rest of the people here in Burbank, California. Have a good night, and we'll see you guys tomorrow.